بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. إن شاء الله we'll resume reading from the path of worshippers, منهاج العابدين. And the very last thing, of course, we read the three verses, poetic verses of poetry. That encourage people to include the hereafter in perspective, that one aims at the hereafter. Yes, that what they endure in this life is basically an investment in the hereafter. And preceding these three verses, we mentioned the story of Sufyan al-Thawri, who exerted extra effort in worship, in obedience, in being connected, if you will, because the distractions disconnect one from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the right perspective on things. So Imam Ghazali continues by saying, commenting on all this, قلت أنا وإذا كان مدار أمر العبودية على الأمرين القيام بالطاعة والانتهاء عن المعصية وذلك لا يتم إلا مع هذه النفس الأمارة بالسوء إلا بترغيب وترهيب وترجية وتخويف، فإن دابة الحرون تحتاج إلى قائد يقودها وإلى سائق يسوقها، وإذا وقعت في مهوات فربما تضرب بالصوت من جانب ويلوح لها بالشعير من جانب آخر حتى تنهض وتتخلص مما وقعت فيه، فإن الصبي العرم لا يمر إلى الكتاب إلا بترجية من الوالدين تخويف من المعلم. كذلك هذه النفس دابة حرون وقعت في أهوات الدنيا، فالخوف صوتها وسائقها، والرجاء شعيرها وقائدها، وإنها الصبي العرم يحمل لكتاب العبادة والتقوى، فذكر النار والعقاب تخويفه، وذكر الجنة وثوابها ترجيته وترغيبه. ولذلك يلزم العبد الطالب للعبادة والرياضة أن يشعر النفس بالأمرين اللذين هما الخوف والرجاء، وإلا فلا تساعده نفسه الجموح على ذلك. وبهذا المعنى أتى الذكر الحكيم بمجموع الأمرين، الوعد والوعيد والترغيب والتهديد، وأبلغ في كل منهما، فذكر من الثواب الكريم ما لا صبر عنه، وذكر من العقاب الأليم ما لا صبر عليه. I say, that's Imam al-Ghazali رحمه الله, servanthood and worship are based on two foundations, embarking upon the path of servanthood and abstaining from sins. Servanthood, obedience, worship. Neither of these is possible for the carnal soul that is inclined to do evil. Therefore, this wild and unruly animal needs one guide who can pull it away from the evil, and another one who can push it to good and virtuous deeds. Imam Ghazali simply mentioned, of course, the animal here is always a domesticated animal, but yet still stubborn. So this wild and unruly animal I wonder whether wild is appropriate in this context, but the idea is an animal that is stubborn. That's the whole thing. That rejects basically to be guided, rejects to go forward. There are such animals, could be a horse, could be a mule, could be a donkey, That way, when it falls into a pit, one can whip it from behind, from one side. Really, that's what it says in Arabic. And the other can hold barley before it, thus motivating it to move forward until it is pulled out and rescued. That's the carrot and the stick, if you will. Similarly, a young boy does not like to go to school except by encouragement of his parents and the fear and respect of his teacher. It's not any boy, really, a young boy. Al-Arim is basically a boy, a child that is difficult to convince, let's say, stubborn, does not listen. So the boy does not like to go to school except by encouragement of his parents and by the fear and respect of his teacher. The carnal soul is like that wild and unruly animal fallen in the pit of the world. Fear is the whip that pushes it out of the pit, while hope is its barley and guide to move it forward. It is like that young boy when he enters the school of righteousness. Worship and piety. Remembering the fire of hell and fear of punishment frightens him, while thinking of paradise and its bounties and blessings encourages him and gives him hope. Therefore, it is necessary for the seeker of worship and ascetic practices to feed his carnal soul with fear and hope. Otherwise, he will not be able to guide his stubborn soul toward worship. To this end, the Holy Quran has prescribed hope, promise, and reward. Fear and threat. Du'ad and wa'id. In attaining both of these ends, great blessings and promise are promised by God that man cannot comprehend on the one hand, and on the other, severe punishments that he cannot endure. It is therefore your duty to be committed to these two great undertakings so that your objectives from worship are attained and hardships are ease for you. God alone is the possessor of success by his grace and generosity. فعليك إذا بالتزام هذين المعنيين يحصل لك مرادك ويحصل عليك احتمال المشقة. والله تعالى ولي التوفيق بفضله ورحمته. The Imam Ghazali poses a theoretical question. فإن قلت فما حقيقة الرجاء والخوف وحكمهما؟ If it is asked, what is the reality of hope and fear? What are their injunctions? The answer, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْخَوْفُ وَرَجَاءَ عِنْدَ عُلَمَائِنَا رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَرْجِعَانِ إِلَى قَبِيلِ الْخَوَاطِرِ وَإِنَّمَا الْمَقْدُورُ الْعَبْدُ مُقَدِّمَاتُهُمَا. Know that in the opinion of our learned men, fear and hope are realizations in the heart. The affairs of the heart are not in the control of the servant, but preparing for them is possible for him. قال والخوف رعدة تحدث في القلب عند ظن مكروه يناله. والخشية نحوه، لكن الخشية تقتضي ضربا من الصعظام للمهابة. وضد الخوف الجراءة، ولكن قد يقابل بالأمن، فيقال خائف وآمن وخوف وأمن، لأن الآمن الذي يجتمع الله سبحانه وتعالى، والحقيقة أن الجراءة تضاده. They say that fear is like a shivering that descends upon the heart out of the dread of committing an abominable act that is forbidden by the law. Another term for it is khashya, except that the latter refers to a greater fear along with respect. The opposite of fear is bravery and courage. Bravery and courage, yes. Jara is daring, really. However, sometimes it also denotes peace. It also denotes peace. No, it's amn, it's security, it's safety. And in the famous story of Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radhiyallahu anhu, that emissary who came looking for him, and he was told that he was sleeping under the tree, and the context is that he was sleeping under the tree, no guards, no, it was in the open. And that emissary said three words in Arabic that are remarkable: عَدَلْتَ فَأَمِنْتَ فَنِمْتَ. So he mentioned the amn, but he preceded that as a obviously as a prerequisite for security, for safety. He told him, you must have been just, therefore you felt safe like this and you slept. And it's a reminder that those who look for security, those who look for, we all look for security. As individuals, on a micro level, the society, the family, the society at large, of course it is interested in security, in peace. But I'm sorry that, really, I'm sorry that when we talk about state actors, it seems that they jump over the in the sense of they do not address justice, nor they discuss justice. So all these conferences about security, all with bar none, all these conferences and seminars and specializations and workshops and meetings in the not in the hundreds, in the thousands, they skip justice, which means they, which means unfortunately that the lack of justice is going to create friction, create problems, create challenges, including security challenges. The root cause, they don't seem to be interested in the root cause of problems. That's what it is. So sometimes it also denotes, rather than peace, we talk about amn, security, safety, as they say. When a man is in fear, another man is in peace and security. It's an interesting, interesting notion, really. The meaning is that a man is a man in peace and security is indifferent to that which God commands. The truth is that fear is the opposite of courage and boldness. Somehow there's something missing here. مقدمات الخوف أربعة. There are four prerequisites for fear. الأولى ذكر الذنوب. ذكر الذنوب الكثيرة التي سبقت وكثرة الخصوم الذين مضوا في المظالم وأنت مرتهن لم يتبين لك الخلاص بعد. والثاني ذكر شدة العقوبة الله سبحانه التي لا طاقة لك بها. والثالثة ذكر ضعف نفسك عن احتمال العقوبة. والرابعة ذكر قدرة الله تعالى عليك متى شاء وكيف شاء. So there are four prerequisites for fear. The first is to remember the many sins you committed in the past and the many enemies whose rights you violated, and that you will not be free from indebtedness to them. Next is to remember that you cannot bear the severity of God's punishment. Those who have rights and that you have violated, you will be stuck until you are realize that you have been relieved from that burden, from that debt. And we talk about the hereafter, because if they have passed away, because this is what it says in Arabic, if they have passed away, you cannot basically give them back what belongs to them. Of course, you might be able to. Of course, it should have been given. What you owe them should have been given to them. But if not, then you try to give it to their offspring. If not, had he traveled to mother also? Had they traveled to another place in the world where you cannot reach them? You might give, a charity as an ongoing good deed, صدقة جارية, on their behalf. But ultimately, just pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will help you get out of this mess on the day of judgment. In the sense of, if they ask for what belongs, for what belongs to them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them. Either ask them to forgive you, give them something in exchange. They might take from your hasanat. If you don't have, they might give you some of their sayyat. I don't know. So we have these four really. So the next is to remember that you cannot bear the severity of God's punishment. The third is to remember your weakness in the face of God's chastisement. The fourth is to remember God's power over you whenever he wills and however he wills. The first one in details. We talk about the رجاء really, hope. وابتهاج القلب بمعرفة فضل الله تعالى واسترواحه إلى سعة رحمة الله تعالى. هذا جملة خواطر غير مقدورة للعبد. ورجاء هو مقدور, وهو تذكر فضل الله تعالى وسعة رحمته, وتسمى أيضا إرادة المخاطرة باستثناء رجاء. والمراد من هذا الباب هو الأول, والتذكر على حسب الابتهاج والاسترواح, وضده اليأس. وتذكر فوات رحمة الله تعالى وفضله وقطع القلب عن ذلك ومعصية محضة. وهذا الرجاء فرض إذا لم يكن للعبد سبيل امتناع عن يأس به إلا به، وإلا فهو نفل بعد اعتقاد الجملة في فضل الله سبحانه وسعة رحمته. As to hope, it is defined as the pleasure and bliss that descends upon the heart by realizing God's grace and peace and comfort by learning of the infinitude of His mercy. These states are not in control of the servant of God. What is in control of the servant is always remembering God's generosity and the infinitude of His mercy. Indeed, this has also been called willingness to accept all harms and dangers of hope. What is intended here is the first one, that is to remember the happiness and comfort of hope. Now to the opposite. ومقدمات الرجاء أربع. الأولى it's just like there were a couple of lines only that will help explain the opposite of hope is despair. Yes, despair means forgetting God's mercy and His generosity and becoming disappointed with His grace. This is pure sin. When man has faith in God's undifferentiated mercy and grace, hope is not obligatory for him. However, when there is no other way for him to avoid despair except through hope in God's mercy and grace, hope becomes an obligatory duty for him. مقدمات الرجاء أربعة. الأولى ذكر سوابق فضله إليك من غير قدم أو شفيع. والثانية ذكر ما وعد به من جزيل ثوابه وعظيم كرامته على حسب فضله وكرمه دون استحقاق إياه بالفعل. إذ لو كان على حسب الفعل لكان أقل شيء وأصغر منه وصار أمر. والثالثة ذكر كثرة نعمه أو ذكر كثرة نعمة الله تعالى عليك في أمر دينك ودنياك في الحال من أنواع الإمداد والألطاف من غير استحقاق أو سؤال. والرابع ذكر سعة رحمة الله تعالى وسبقها غضبه وأنه الرحمن الرحيم الغني الكريم الرؤوف بعباده المؤمنين. فإذا وضعت على هذه النوعين من الأذكار أفضيا بك إلى استشعار الخوف والرجاء بكل حال. والله تعالى ولي التوفيق منه وفضله. There are also prerequisites for hope. The first is to remember God's grace, generosity, and all the bounties He had already granted you without your effort or an intercessor. Without effort, yes. Or intercessor, Shafia. Next is to remember what God has promised in terms of great rewards and blessing in accordance with His generosity and mercy. Without your deserving by your deeds and with no consideration for them. If He will to grant you blessings in proportion to your deeds, your rewards would be much less and insignificant. The third prerequisite of hope is to remember the many bounties and blessings God granted you in the affairs of your religion and the world, such as many types of help and favors without your requesting or deserving them. And the fourth is to remember the infinitude of God's mercy and that His mercy supersedes His wrath. For He is the most merciful. the most compassionate. Al-Ghani, which we spoke about the problem with translating it as the rich, is the self-sufficient, the clement, and the most generous to his believing servant. If you always observe these directions by God, by God's grace, you will perceive and attain stations of hope and fear in all situations. He alone is the possessor of success. And we come now to another title. في وجوب أخذ الاحتياط عند قطع عقبة البواعث. فعليك أيها الرجل بقطع هذه العقبة في تمام الاحتياط والتحرز ونهاية الرعاية، فإنها عقبة دقيقة المسلك، خطرة الطريق، وذلك أن طريقها بين طريقين مخوفين مهلكين، أحدهما طريق الأمن والثاني طريق اليأس. Excursus, it is your duty to traverse through this valley, through this obstacle, fear and hope, with utmost care and caution, for it is a very sensitive and dangerous valley, and is situated between two frightening and deadly paths. One of these is the path of peace and security, and the other is the path of despair. وطريق الرجاء والخوف هو الطريق العدل بين الطريقين الجائرين. فإن غلب الرجاء عليك حتى فقدت الخوف البتة، وقعت في طريق الأمن، ولا أمن مكر الله إلى القوم الخاسرون. وإن غلب الخوف عليك حتى فقدت الرجاء البتة، وقعت في طريق اليأس، ولا يأس من روح الله إلا القوم الكافرون. فإن كنت ركبت بين الرجاء والخوف اعتصمت بهما جميعا، هو الطريق العدل المستقيم التي هي سبيل أولياء الله تعالى وأصفيائه الذين وصفهم بقوله إنهم كانوا يسارعون في الخيرات ويدعوننا رغبا ورهبا وكانوا لنا خاشعين. إنهم كانوا يسارعون في الخيرات ويدعوننا رغبا ورهبا وكانوا لنا خاشعين. So the path of fear and hope is the path of striking balance between these two frightening paths. If hope overcomes you and fear completely disappears from you, then you shall fall in the path of peace. Remember that God says, none feels secure against God's advising, but the people of the lost. And if fear dominates over you and hope disappears, you shall fall in the path of despair. Then remember that God says, do not despair of God's comfort. Of God's comfort, no one despairs, excepting the people of the unbelievers. However, if you tread the path between fear and hope and resort to both, you are in the straight path of justice, maybe on the straight path of justice. This is the path of the friends of God, Awliya Allah, and the purified Asfiya, whom God describes when he says, truly, they vied with one another, hastening to good works, and called upon us after yearning and awe, and they were humble to us. وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. فَإِذَنْ ظهر لك في هذه العقبة ثلاثة طرق: طريق الأمن والجراءة، وطريق اليأس والقنوط، وطريق الخوف والرجاء ممتد بينهما. فإن ملت عنه بقدم إلى يمينك أو يسارك وقعت في المهل في المهلكين وهلكت مع في المهلكين وهلكت مع الهالكين. وقعت في المهلكين وهلكت مع الهالكين. مهلك مهلكان مهلكين. ثم الشأن أن طريقين الجائرين مهلكين أوسع مجالا وأكثر داعيا وأسهل سلوكا من طريق العدل، لأنك إذا نظرت من جانب الأمن رأيت من سعة رحمة الله وكثرة فضله وغاية جوده ما لا يبقى لك معه خوف، فتتكل على ذلك بمرة وتأمن. وإن نظرت من جانب الخوف رأيت من عظيم سياسة الله تعالى وكثرة هيبته ودقة أمره وغاية مناقشاته ومناقشة مع أوليائه وصفيائه ما لا يكاد يبقى لك معه رجاء، فتيأس بمرة وتقلق. It becomes clear to you now there are in fact three paths before you in this valley: the path of peace, and fearlessness, the path of despair, and the path of hope and fear that runs parallel in the middle of them. If you lean to your right or left, you'll fall into one of these two deadly valleys and will be destroyed along with others. These two deadly and destructive paths are wider, more tempting, and are easier to travel on than the path of hope and fear. This is because when you look for from within the path of peace, you'll see so much of God's mercy and utmost generosity that no fear will remain in your heart. You'll feel completely safe. Alternatively, if you look from within the path of fear, all will you see is God's power and majesty, His wrath and formidable presence, the correctness of His affairs, and His utmost challenge of His friends and purified ones. You will lose hope and be taken over by despair. Therefore, you need not look at God's infinite mercy alone and depend on it and feel safe, nor should you look at His infinite majesty and the challenges that may result in disappointment and despair. فتحتاج إذن ألا تنظر إلى سعة رحمة الله تعالى فقط حتى تتكل وتأمن، ولا إلى عظيم الهيبة والمناقشة فقط حتى تقمط ولا يأس، بل تنظر إلى هذا وإلى هذا جميعا وتأخذ من هذا بعضا وهذا بعضا، فتركب بينهما طريقا دقيقا وتسلك ذلك لتسلم. فإن طريق الرجاء المحض سهل واسع عريض، وعاقبته تؤديك الأمن والخسران، وطريق الخوف المحض واسع عريض، وعاقبته تؤديك إلى الضلال والكفران، وطريق العدل بينهما طريق الخوف والرجاء، وإن كان دقيقا عسيرا أو عسرا فإنه سبيل سالم ومنهج بين يؤدي إلى الغفران والإحسان، ثم إلى الجنان والرضوان ولقاء الملك الرحمن سبحانه. أما تسمع قوله تعالى في أبناء هذا السبيل يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا، ثم قال فلا تعلم نفس ما أخفي لهم من قرة أعين جزاء بما كانوا يعملون. فتأمل هذه الجملة جدا وتشمر وتنبه الأمر، فإنه لا يجيء بالهوينة، والله الموفق. You will lose hope and be taken over by despair. Therefore, you need not look at God's infinite mercy alone and depend on it and feel safe. Nor should you look at His infinite majesty and the changes that may result in disappointment and despair. Rather, look at all these together. Take some from this one and some from the other, and tread a fine path between them. You tread that path to be safe, for the path of absolute hope is too vast and will end in illusory sense of security and ultimate loss. Similarly, the path of pure fear is also vast and ends in loss and deviation. The right and just path, therefore, is between these two, that is, the path of fear and hope together. This is the difficult and demanding path, but it is the safest and most direct. It leads to forgiveness, goodness, salvation, and paradise, and ultimately to meeting the King, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most compassionate. Praise belongs to Him alone. Listen to what God says to the travelers on this path. They call on their Lord in fear and hope. No soul knows what comfort is laid up for them secretly as a recompense for that they were doing. Reflect on this, saying with the utmost effort, bear that in mind and take heed, for it will not be easy, but God is the possessor of success. We are left with one paragraph before we reach a new subtitle, major subtitle. So bear with me. فتأمل هذه الجملة جدا تشمر وتنبه الأمر فإن لا يجيء الهوينة ولا موفق ثم أعلم أنه يتأترك سلوك هذه الطريق وحمل هذه النفس الجموح الكسلان تعالى الخير باجتناب المحبوب عندها واكتساب الطاعات الثقيلة عليها إلا بالتحفظ بثلاثة أصول وتذكر لها على سبيل الدوام غير فترة ولا غفلة. أحدها ذكر قوله تعالى بالترغيب والترهيب، والثاني ذكر أفعاله سبحانه في الأخذ والعفو، والثالث ذكر جزاء العباد في المعاد من الثواب والعقاب، وتفصيل كل أصل منها يحتاج إلى صحف كثيرة، ولأجلها صنفنا كتاب تنبيه الغافلين، ونحن نشير في هذا الكتاب إلى كلمات توقفك على المقصود إن شاء الله تعالى. No, that is not possible to travel on this path and induce the wild and lazy carnal soul to do good deeds. Abstain from that, abstain from what it likes, and accept the heavy burden of worship unless you observe three principles continuously and without interruption and negligence. One of them is to remember what God has said concerning hope and fear. Another is to remember God's acts regarding reward and punishment. The third is to remember how He rewards and or punishes His servants on the day of return, on the day of judgment. Differentiated explanation of these principles requires many more pages. For this purpose, we have compiled another book called Admonition of the People of Negligence, Tanbih al-Ghafilin. In the following pages, we shall make a few remarks that God willing can guide us to your destination. Majestic and glorious is He, and He is the possessor of success. Inshallah, next we will deal with the first principle concerning what God, praise be to Him, has said about hope and fear. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. نشهد الآن نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.